today, so I'm going to share to you some of the work that I did in my PhD, which I only finished in 2017. And so, like my mum Etty, well, we were actually, Etty and I were involved when I was doing my master's, and she was starting her PhD in a project in New Zealand looking at TB. So my TB, my master's thesis, this one, was on Maki Maro, on how Cook Islands got eliminated TB. We're the only country in the world to almost eliminate tuberculosis. And at the time that we did that, we only had one doctor in the whole country. And so I think what I've really noticed with COVID-19 is that we have utilised a whole lot of strategies that we used back then in the early 1900s for eliminating TB, like taking all of the Ministry of Health sites to the villages, working with predominantly women's organisations and villages, keeping an eye on people that need medication and needed support, those sorts of things. So that was my master's thesis, looking at the Cook Islands health systems and what they put in place to eliminate TB, because in countries around the world, TB is on the way up again. And there's also antibiotic resistant tuberculosis, so in other countries, but ours, we eliminated it, and actually we only have like 1 to 2 cases a year now, and it's usually from people coming back into the country because TB can lie dormant in your body, and it's not until something like maybe you're older and get diabetes or things like that, and then your body, your immune system is compromised and the TB can reactivate. So it's a very interesting and fascinating area. I've, you know, 36 years now been in education, so jumping into doing a master's in history was a steep learning curve for me, and you have to do things quite differently in history in another discipline than you do in education, and so I'm telling a story. So it was hard work. I had to put my big girl hunters on to work out how to do that, and then I was looking at the Ministry of Health then, and that's why I did that. But also because it was related to health, and that's where my interest had been for a long time. And then when I finished at the Te Marae, I got a Commonwealth scholarship, and I went to Australia and did my PhD. I also worked full-time all the way through my PhD. So I was a part-time student and a full-time worker. And so, see this? New nice colour right here. I didn't have that nice colour when I started, but I certainly had it at the end. Some people pay a lot of money for this colour.
Come on.
Yeah. So I'm not going to say it wasn't hard work. You've heard from every single person along the way that there were times that you really thought, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? The times that you would spend away from your family on the weekends working, when really you just wanted to be with your family, or, you know, everybody has dramas in their PhD. If my mother had breast cancer, James's mother died, his father came to live with us, my daughter got married, had a baby, so all of those things happen, and you can't stop your PhD, you have to just keep going, and you just, like, I just saw it like this, like little baby steps. You just keep moving forward, even if it's only a little bit. And so I set myself goals of things like 500 words a day. And some days I could do that like that, and some days it took me all day.
Sorry, Debi, 500 words. You never miss it.
Thank you. The money's in there. Yeah. Would you mind just letting me know that the money's in the office, please? Thank you. We're going to a wedding this afternoon. Okay, so yeah, part-time, you know, and it's like everybody said, you don't get through one of these higher qualifications without lots of people with you. And you might be the one that at the end has a piece of paper, but actually you just can't do it without, you know, all sorts of people along the way helping you. Actually, Jim down the back was one of the people that helped me with some of my data along the way. So, Jim, thank you. The statistics man, which is not me at all. So, what did I do?
Yeah. The question is why? One of the things that I've learned through my time working at the MOE and here was that a lot of the time what happens in the Cook Islands is driven by outside agencies and outside people telling us what we need to do here. And it's like, actually, we need to find out from our own people what they think, and we drive development from Cook Islanders' voices. So that was one of the reasons, you know, constantly we were told from, did she tell them who the money was?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great, thank you. When the committee needed this done,
I could see that my work would be useful for and improve things at the local base. You know, not just about me completing my qualification. I wanted this to be useful to the proponents. So there's sort of that talk about insider, outsider. You know, Tainer talked about, you know, how he followed master in some research in one of the Pāinua, and his data was completely different because he had that Cook Islands understanding of what was being said, and that Cook Islanders said things to him that they wouldn't say to a or an outsider or a person they didn't trust. Yeah? But I think what happened, you know, with me being involved with young people in the Cook Islands through my work at the Ministry of Education, my work through Te Tiare Association, SIFWA, all of those things, and the fact that my kids were still at school at this, you know, they were young people. So other young people knew me as Samantha and Jordan's mother. And so that gave me inroads with young people that I wouldn't have had if I wasn't, you know, hadn't been here, or if I'd come just straight from another university as a person who wanted to look at this. You know, so young people trusted me because my politics were quite known about that. I thought young people should have good information, because without good information you can't make good decisions. And so that's kind of my philosophy. So Tiruana Moa Hodges and I go back a long way. She was my lecturer when I was at Akapai in Wellington, Victoria College, Wellington College of Education. And then when I was at the Ministry of Education, Tiruana was the principal of the Teachers Training College, right? And James was a lecturer at the Teachers Training College, and I lectured there too. And Tiruana, as part of her master's project, was developing a Cook Islands research framework called the tivaevae. It's very famous. She didn't end up finishing her master's using the tivaevae. She actually only finished her master's last year, I think it was, and she's in her 70s. And she still was working at Futter-Puati when I was still working out. Like, I couldn't find the work that she had done around to read. Everyone references it, but no one actually, there is no copy. So I did extensive trying to find the copies, even went to Tiruana herself, and she doesn't have a copy anymore either. But Tiruana talks about these key values that should be in research. And if you think about it, when you start making a tivaevae, you have to collect all the materials before you can get started. You have to decide what your pattern is going to be. When you do your research, you have to decide what your topic is going to be. You have to get all of your materials, the fabrics, the pattern that you will cut, the needles, the cottons that you will use. That's like doing your literature review. You know, you have to get all of the things ready to be able to do the tivaevae like you have to do your research. And then you have to have a tivaevae dauma, someone who leads the group to do the to start the sewing. Yes? The expert in tivaevae. And so when you're doing research, you go to the experts in your field, and you read their work and you talk with them. So what Tiruana was saying around how we prepare to make our tivaevae was very similar to the way that we prepare to work to develop our research. But with a Cook Islands lens on it, they must have these values. You know, we've got to make sure that we collaborate. So I was working with the HIV STI TB committee, that's a big mouthful. And so I was collaborating with them, and I was collaborating with NGOs that work in the area of sexual health. Okay, so SIFWA was the main one. But that question of, you know, collaboration is really important, like, because they're the people who will keep this data safe. So I could be somebody that is actually here doing this research for my own benefit, take it away to New Zealand and then sell it and make money from it, or, you know, depends on the research is. But the collaboration means that you're keeping the project and the data. survivors safe and the participants safe. And the state on that thing. The question of making sure that Cook Islanders benefit, that's what tivaevae is asking, and that's what most Indigenous research frameworks will ask. How do Indigenous people who are involved in this project benefit from this project? It's not just about the researcher. And whose desires are represented? Is it just the researcher that's looking to do this, or other people want this information as well? You know? So I knew that the way that I was working by using Tim Runner's framework was that I was making sure that I was collaborating with local people. It wasn't just about me. I also wanted to make sure, like I did check-ins with the HIV committee as I was going along, that this is what I'm doing, this is why I'm doing it, and so that's, they could, you know, it wasn't just me in control of the project, it was other people as well. We knew what the positive outcomes were going to be. The desire was that once we got this data, we would be able to develop a Cook Islands sexuality education resource. This is what it looks like, except I'll give one book away for someone to have a look at, but she's bringing it back. But we ended up having this whole kit published based on the data from young people and designed 20 lessons from what young people told us were their, what was actually happening in their lives. Rather than using a New Zealand or Australian resource, we had our own data, the kids had told us what was really going on, which was way different to what we thought was going on. And then I took that data and wrote that up into an education resource for community organisations to use and schools to use. So tapu teaches with this. At Te Ora they teach with it. Māori they teach with it. We, you know, UNESCO funded the publication. So that's where the reciprocity happens, you know, the giving back. We were thinking also about who's accountable. I was definitely accountable back to that HIV committee. It wasn't just about me. It wasn't just the university that was accountable. I was accountable because of the relationships that I have with people here. You know? And that's the difference around taking an Indigenous approach. In fact, when you're inside a community, you have way more expectations placed on you than someone that can just shoot in and shoot out. Because everyone knows what you're doing and they want to hear about it and they want you to, you know, they hold you accountable as they should. In terms of the shared vision, that's again those questions about who benefits and who's designed the questions of your research project. So when you think about your own projects, you are collaborative, you're working with staff and students in your school or your community. You're hoping that this research will benefit both like the ministry, your school and the children, because what you're doing in your own little projects in this class will be new knowledge that's going on in terms of reputiaani, but will help shape whatever policy comes out or practice that comes out later. Yeah? So, when you do a PhD and a master's sometimes, I didn't have to in history, but you do in other subjects, you have to have what's called a theoretical framework. I'm not going to talk much about this, but in terms of Tina Moana's research framework, she hadn't really thought about the use of the theoretical framework within the site of the tivaevae. So, I asked Tina Moana if I could build on her research framework when I did my PhD. So in terms of thinking about the tivaevae and a research project, I used the metaphor of threading the needle with more than one cotton, so that as I did my stitches, or as I collected my data and wrote up my findings, the theoretical framework makes you think of the way that you design your questions, and it makes you think of the way that you read the findings that you bring in. So feminist post-structural theory is about thinking about gender. It's about unpacking what's happening in terms of the way that things happen for within gender, the young men in the study, the young women in the study.
study of academia, the finance, that kind of thing.
The post-colonial theory was looking about how has the colonisation of the Cook Islands impacted on these ideas for young people. Yeah, and feminist in terms of really looking at things from an angle where you're challenging the status quo. So I won't talk much more about that, but I did thread my needle with these theories and it made me think differently from the way that, challenged me to think differently. So what did I do? So because I was working collaboratively with Te Marae Ora at the time, they were doing their questionnaire. I was about to do my questionnaire when I found out that they were going to do a questionnaire too. So I put my questions in their questionnaire. So one of the things that I think happens here is that we regularly are researched, okay? And people come in and do research. And so like we put them together. So there were some questions in that questionnaire from me, some from Te Marae Ora, and some from the census, I think, if I remember rightly. So there were actually quite a lot of questions that ended up in this questionnaire. And for this questionnaire was done with 674 young people. Now you remember Tana said 5% of the population gives you robust stats. Well, this was more than 20% of the youth population at the time. Okay, so that's, what the data that we got, we can say is pretty generalised across all young people.
The age group did you choose? Why did you choose 15 to 24? Because the latest one is 15 to 36. Had different couple of years.
Yeah.
So was there any particular reason why you chose that age group, 15 to 24?
Yeah. Because most countries consider youth 15 to 24, and actually in the youth policy it's now changed to 15 to 24 for youth in the Cook Islands too, but it was at the time when Nettie did it, because our youth were like 34 or something.
India is 12. The youth is 12.
Yeah.
It's a legal age for men.
Yeah.
India is 12.
Yeah. All right. Crazy, but yeah. 20% of the population, and we did a survey/questionnaire. I had 35 questions in there, which actually is way too many questions, and I haven't even used half that data yet. And focus groups. So I sat down with young groups of people, groups of young people, and talked with them about things. And then I also did some interviews. So WHO actually funded some tablets for us to do this work, because there had been very little research done around the Pacific youth. And so we actually got 5 tablets and we got some money to train 5 young people to do these questionnaires for us. And so I'm a whare myself, Tangata Whare. We did the training and of the 5 young people, and then they got paid to go out and do some interviews. They got $10 per interview, and anyone who participated anyone that participated received a $10 voucher for either phone credit or petrol voucher. So there were incentives to participate. Just talking to Craig this morning, it wouldn't be considered a bribe because it's not big enough, it's not like grandiose. It was about respecting their time that it took to take part and respecting their knowledge that they were sharing with us. And the consent was verbal. So if they took part in the filling in the questionnaire on the notebook, then it was consent. Because if they didn't fill in the questionnaire, they were not consenting. Okay? So
and also the 15-year-olds.
Yeah, 15 to 24. And the reason we did 15, not 16, was because the 2007 health survey was with 15 to 24 year olds, And so I had to go back to ethics 7 times to get this through for 15 rounds. And, you know, 15 and 6. Put those two together and you've got problems with ethics.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we did have a precedent and that it had been done before. And one of the things that when you're doing research around sensitive areas, like talking about sexuality or sex, is that if you're never allowed to talk to young people, you never know what's really going on. And so there are ways to get consent, of course, but you know, these kids were not going to go and ask their parents because their parents would say no, right? And if they thought that their parents would see the data at all, they would not have participated. Because we wanted them to share, you know, what was really happening so that we could design something that was actually really useful rather than what adults think is going on, because we often get it wrong. So 674 people completed the questionnaire. But there were 81 young people in the focus groups, and I also talked with, young people from Sikwa, young people from Riveract, and that just go off. And Cesa, who else did I talk to? So, my battery, okay. Yep, let's turn it on. It should be, okay. We're self-interested. Yeah, so what that meant was talking to lots of different people. I talked to one group in Aachu, all the senior students in Aachu, is that you get multiple perspectives. It's not just like the rugby players from CESA, you know, the sports association, or not just the young woman from Sifwa. You get, when you talk to multiple groups, you get multiple ideas about these things. And then as a researcher, you're looking for what the common themes are that come out from those conversations. Oh, Tetiari was another group that I spoke to. But almost everybody was from the Pacific. There was only one Papa'ara and two Papa'ara and one Fijian Indian that were included. Everybody else was Cook Islander. And what I... Yeah?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
During your interview time, how did these people react to the questions?
The young people had.
There was one group that was quite up among, and I think it was because their kevereiro was sitting there with them. And I think that they were modifying their comments because they didn't want to say some of the things in front of them. And when he left, things opened up more. But when it was just me, and I spoke to them about what I wanted to do with the data, why I wanted the data, so they understood those things, and that no one else would see the data except for my supervisors and myself. I made sure that they understood what was going to happen with the data. And then, boy, did I hear lots of things. lots and lots of things, and it was very interesting. But I was also there not to judge anything, because that was never my role to judge. And as a health educator, I know that if I judge, then I straight away lose my students, because I'm actually saying that what you're doing is wrong. If you take that stance, you're never going to be able to explore something fully.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I did. So Louisa Allen, she's a professor at the University of Auckland, had done a similar study with New Zealand young people, but there were almost no Pacific people in her study. And so I adapted some questions from her, and I also added some other questions, because I was interested to see if we would find the same thing here as she found in New Zealand. And we found actually quite different things in lots of areas. I did do some interviews too of all the people who were teaching sexuality in the country. There weren't that many, 6 NGOs and 3 teachers. What was interesting is that nobody had any training in sexuality education. They might have been a nurse or a counsellor, but they actually hadn't had any specific training in sexuality education, but they were running these
courses for young people. I actually decided not to put any of the data from these interviews into my PhD in the end, and I wrote a little piece about why I decided to take that stance. And that was predominantly because I didn't want adult voices to outspeak youth voices. I wanted to make sure that what youth had said was at the forefront. I think Nettie talked about it too, didn't she, about how when you have adults and children speaking, it's often the adults that are only the ones listened to. So what did I find out? You can imagine with that many questions, and I think my supervisor said I had enough data that I never had to do another research project ever again, because it's one of those things that you think you have to do it this big, but actually it's only this big, and your mind's that big. Okay. So what was really interesting is that Māpu absolutely identified themselves as sexualized humans. They were involved in sex in different ways, in a variety of different ways. They've been brought up around sex in terms of knowing that it happens, often in communal living situations. All of the jokes, the dances, the legends, all the rest of it. So much of those things that are so much part of the crime's life are around sex, actually. And so, if we think children are naive about sex, they're not. They're very savvy, they know what's going on. That we were going to have to design the sexuality education resource around the fact that to make sure that young people could safely navigate a variety of types of relationships that they were involved in. Most young people, and in fact most Kokanas, do not wait until they get married to have sex. Mm. In fact, the average age of first sex was 15, mm. and 40% of the participants had sex at 14. Just need that.
I think retired at 40%.
Yeah, so that's the thing, you see. So what we're doing here is by not educating young people is actually the countries that have really good comprehensive sexuality education, their age of first sexual debut, I call it, not losing your virginity, is usually planned and is over the age of 18. So in those countries, young people are actually thinking that when I'm older and I have found a person that has these sorts of attributes, like these are the things I'm looking for. It's not just tall, dark and handsome either. It's like educated, someone that I can trust, someone that I can laugh with, that we have similar interests and values and beliefs. And then, when I found someone like that, I'm going to think about how I will share this part of my life with him, rather than getting drunk at rehab, on the rocks, having sex and not remembering it in the morning. Because lots of young people that I spoke with had what I call regrettable first sexual experiences, or that they had them but they wish that they hadn't done that in that way, and they made those decisions because they didn't have enough knowledge to plan it and to think carefully about it. And that was what was contributing to our really high STI rates. At the time there was a 46% STI rate with our young people, and quite a high teenage pregnancy rate, which Nettie talked about the other day as well. So really that final point there, that the education resource had to work on developing the capacity of Māpu to enjoy equitable, so relationships that were based on equal values, not one partner being better than the other, responsible, so that they worked with each other about deciding when they would have a family. That they wouldn't put the other person at risk, or that they wouldn't do something to them that they wouldn't like. Yeah? Fulfilling, that they got back from that relationship, they just didn't give. Yeah? Healthy, that's about mental and emotional health. We know that our rates of sexual and domestic violence are really high in Cook Islands. The National Council of Women's study, Shadows of My Heart, showed really almost all women in the Cook Islands in that study had experienced domestic violence at some stage in their lives. So that was the goal, was to develop the skills that would give people these kinds of relationships so that when they decided that they would become sexual with somebody, that it would be a respectful, equitable, fulfilling and healthy relationship. I think that's what we all want for our kids, right? If they choose somebody that will love and cherish them and look after them, yes, and that they can do that for themselves. And when I started to look at the research, what the research that shows that kids have those skills is when they have more information, not less information. The more information they have, the more likely they are to make good decisions. And so, the idea was to create a resource also using Tivaevae's values. So those values reciprocity, respect, will also go into all of the lessons. So when I was thinking about these values and looking at the data and what I found, and thinking about how do I take the fact that 20% of our young people have more than one sexual relationship at a time. And they tell me that they learned that from adults, that their parents aren't always good role models. It's not the kinds of things that they told me. In fact, every single group that I spoke to said that adults were not good role models. Oh. Yeah. And so, they said they think our parents don't know that my dad has that woman over there or my mum has blah blah, but we know. And we all know that there's children sitting in our classrooms that have got the same fathers, but maybe they don't know it themselves. Or when we start to do our genealogies, who's that one over there? Where does he come from? Or that one over there, where does she come from? Everybody's laughing, right? It's true, eh? You know? Yeah. So I think they're probably right that not just young people have more than one relationship at a time, but quite often adults have more relationships than one relationship at a time. I'd love to do this questionnaire with, you know, over 24s, and I reckon we'd find very similar things. So let's just take that finding. How was I going to design a lesson that would make sure that people would stay healthy and looked after when they're having more than one relationship at a time? Because one of the other findings in here was that most of the dramas that happen with young people occur around breakups, or finding out their partner was cheating. And so I had this great moment with this group. They were all boys, all young men. And I said, so, because they were talking about, you know, I'm going to get her, and I did this. I had the revenge steps, he called it, with her best friend. And I said, so, you know, they talked about the dramas that came up with cheating. And I said, so if we have a lesson in here about how to break up kindly or how to be honest if you want to have more than one partner at a time, that means you both have to do that, not just your partner, but both you as well. And he just kind of looked at me like, yeah. It's like, you mean I can only have one person at a time, and if I expect her just to have one person at a time, it's just like, I'm not so sure I want that in there. So it was a real interesting moment of watching these young men think. And so that's what I mean about taking Tivaevae's values into the lessons. How am I going to make sure that everybody is respected? And the only way that you can do that if you're going to have more than one relationship at a time is to be honest. And so there is actually one lesson in this which was highly contentious, and I wasn't sure if it would end up staying in there. But is around this idea of polyamory, which is that you can have more than one relationship at a time, but everybody knows about it. Because then the dramas don't fall out of that, if you're honest. So if I say, I'm going to have a relationship with Teriyaki, but I'm also going to have a relationship with Retire, and then we all know about it, then there's no way you and I'm also having a relationship with you, but you don't know, and then you find out and you get upset. So, yeah. So, when we piloted this, the lessons, because we brought in teachers from the Pāinoa and two from each school, and when I piloted the lessons with the teachers, I thought this was the one I was not so sure about. And people forgot my look, they thought I was talking about polygamy, which is having nine wives and one husband, and I was not talking about that. But, and in the end, when we worked through it, the teachers all and community educators could see that, yes, okay, if this is the drama that is happening and that more than 20% of our young people are having more than one relationship at a time, we do have to think about how we do that safely. So, yeah. So it was interesting taking her research framework and like building on it and using it further and thinking about what we did. So to do those, to incorporate those values, these are the sort of, this is the philosophy I took into the educational resource, that young people can act as agents of change, that they can do things in their lives, they don't need adults to do them for them, okay? And that they are not the ones that need to change, but they can decide, if they have good information, they can make these changes for themselves. I was trying to counter that sort of medicalised way of thinking about sexuality education, that it wasn't just about STIs and pregnancy, because young people said they wanted to learn things like how to break up kindly. To me, that was a really mature adult response. You know, when I asked them, what kinds of things do you want to learn? They said, we don't want to have these terrible fights when we break up or just send a text. We want to know how, we want to learn when this relationship is unhealthy for me. So that I have the skills to leave that relationship if it's unhealthy for me. You know, these are like the kinds of things we can be absolutely proud of our young people, that they were saying these wise, mature things about what they wanted to learn. They know to use a condom. You know, they know that. It's just that we can't always get them when they need them, like Nettie said the other day. But these were the sophisticated skills that they want to know. We as adults need to learn these things sometimes, don't we?
Yes.
You know? Yeah. So, this, you know, that was the approach. They took a critical approach. So it was about looking at scenarios and thinking about who's benefiting if we let this continue and who's being disadvantaged. And lots of times it was young women who were being disadvantaged, but not always. Sometimes it was young men. Sometimes it was parents, because you know, parents forcing their kids to get married even though they did not want to get married. They had like a one-night stand. Well, the kids called it tack and gap, which I think is hilarious. So like, gap it is a really
useful
kind of slang thing. One of my supervisors was from the UK. And never see that person again. I said, you might know it as like a one-night stand, but so young people were having lots of one-off, you know, one-night stands. And so this was about, so if you both think that that's okay, and you both know that you're going to do that, then nobody is hurt in that situation. But if one of you thinks that this is the beginning of a long-term, that you're doing this because this person is going to be your boyfriend or girlfriend for a long time, then you are being disadvantaged or the other one is being disadvantaged. So having those sorts of lessons where they can think about who's advantaged and who's disadvantaged, one of the questions, key questions all the way through. Lots of skill development, communication skills, scenarios like that, two couple of balls there. lots of practicing how you would, what you would say if you wanted to break up with somebody, or if you were wanting someone to do something differently to you than what you were having done, or that kind of thing, all right? So, which is not easy talking, and as adults we find those things different. Judith Butler talks about a youth view of their preferred futures.
So this was about taking what young people wanted for their futures and giving them the skills to be able to have what they desired, what they want in relationships. And it was also, there was also an underlying agenda which was about promoting critical action and social justice, because the kids in the, especially in the focus groups, talked about a lot of injustices that were happening in schools and in communities, particularly with people who were from the LGBT community. And so there were a lot of times where the lessons were saying, okay, so at the end of the lesson they would be given like a tivaevae framework, and there were key questions on there like, what would your mentors say about this lesson? What would your parents say about this lesson? What would your friends say about this lesson on each square? And now that you've done this lesson and you know that these are the things that the people that surround you would say, what do you say? So we're trying to get young people to understand that they are influenced in multiple ways, that they hear messages from their parents, from their friends, from their church, from the media, social media that they're on, and now they need to make up their own mind. And they've got the information in the lesson, and now what do they think themselves? And so that's critical thinking, yeah? So this was the content that the 20 lessons ended up. We could have had about 50 lessons, but we only, you know, we decided 20 was also, was quite optimistic, really, to get through. And I know what Tapu does in her class is she does 10 with year 9 and 10 with year 10. And so, you know, we cover a whole lot, obviously human development, personal skills such as exploring your own attitudes and values, because sometimes we haven't actually stopped and thought, well, why do I think that, you know, until we're given the opportunity. Well, oh, I thought that because my mother told me to think that, you know, like, sometimes you want to hold on to that, and then sometimes you don't, you know, because it depends when you stop to really think about it, and think, oh, actually, I don't really believe that, you know, so you need the time to explore it. Decision making, communication, negotiation, and how to ask for help, because we all need help sometimes in our relationships. I don't believe any relationship is ever immune to needing help sometimes. We all need help sometimes. You know, I mean, I've had counselling in my life because of sometimes some things went wrong. And I think if we don't know how to ask for help, it's a really important skill that we that impacts on our health and well-being. If we don't have those skills to say, I need some help here. Because we can't always know all the answers for ourselves, you know? Relationships. We've looked a lot at friendships. One of the lessons that everybody found really powerful was on a big piece of paper, getting young people just to write down all of the characteristics of their friends that they love. So it's things like, oh, we do the same things, or I can tell them anything, trust them, we laugh together, they're always there for me, blah, 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 all those kinds of things. And then I see the question then is, so if you were going to have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, what would be different to these things that you've already got there? And the only real difference is some kind of, you know, that kind of sexual tension or some kind of sexual attraction, yeah? So they might say, oh, they would say something like, oh, six-pack or something like that. And I say, but would you look for, so these are the kinds of things that you look for in your friends. Would you want to look for those sorts of things in a partner? Because if you look for those things in a partner and that shush, that little tension thing that's there, then chances are that will be a really good relationship for you, because these are the kinds of things you look for in your friends, and then there's that little bit of difference. Rather than just looking for somebody with a six-pack, yes? Let's look for somebody with all of those values, you know? And yes, you know what I mean? So that was a lesson, and you can see young people thinking, oh yeah, I get that, you know, and so it's like thinking more deeply about who do you want to share your life with, who do you want to have this kind of intimate relationship with. It's not just somebody that's sexy, it's somebody that's got all of that as well, yeah?
Yep.
Sex. Yep. Looking at society, keeping yourself healthy. So of course there were things in there about STIs and pregnancy, but it was only very small. It's only a few lessons out of the 20, like three or four, if I remember rightly. It was based on what was actually happening here, rather than a New Zealand or Australian resource or Fijian resource. That, you know, so all of the lessons were based on situations that young people had talked to me about in my research. And we looked at how we can look at the policies and practices of schools and how they could support the lessons as well. The pedagogical approaches were taken. I asked kids in the focus groups, how do you like to learn? And they like to learn by doing active kind of sessions, right? We know that because we're specific children, you know? And so all of the lessons are participatory, but they're getting up and doing things, working in groups, having to move around the room, or talk, act out, practice by role play, those sorts of things. I don't usually call it role play, I call it skills practice. Because as soon as you say role play, everyone is everybody. But as if you say, like, we're practicing these skills, and this is a chance to practice them, then people hear it differently, you know? So we use lots of scenarios that kids had told me, and young people know that these things happen. For example, you know, if something would happen to girls who were sexually active, like girls can be called a slut or something like that if they were sexually active, but boys are somehow seen as a stud. You know, like why is there this difference in asking those questions? But there's also in this kit, there's all sorts of like activity cards and case studies. So these were studies, like things that had been told to me. And so we used them as little stories that the kids can read and then think about in terms of the certain questions that the teachers have got to ask, or that they've got to ask. And actually all of these with the nine on them are actually stories from people who grew up in the Cook Islands who are part of the LGBT community and what it was like for them growing up and what it's like for them now. And so one of them is an Orometua and whose son is gay, and the challenges that happened for him in terms of his beliefs and in terms of his relationship with his child and how he really had to rethink a whole lot of things. And so that's pretty interesting, and these people's names are on some of those, and they're willing to be continue to be part of it. So the study did show us that for the first time how many people in the Cook Islands are part of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender community. And it was 9.1%. So for Ashley, there was 22% of the participants in the questionnaire did not answer that question, who said they were either unsure or were unwilling to answer that question. So even in an anonymous questionnaire, there were still people who were worried that their information might get out. Because I think if you're straight or heterosexual, you just tick that box and you move on, but you don't actually have to think about it much, because you'll never be discriminated against. But if you're not part of someone, like a woman who wants to be with a man or a man who wants to be with a woman, then you do have to think twice. And so I think that this gap here is way, way underrepresented. I think that we've got far more than 10%, way more than 10% of our population who is part of the LGBT community. And so if we had 10% who had COVID, what do you reckon would be happening? There'd be lots of rethinking about the ways we do things. At the moment, we've got legislation in front of it needs to change, that says if someone's in a same-sex relationship, they're a criminal. Whereas in fact, most people in the Cook Islands have quite liberal views around that, and about things, you know, things happen in Akawane, for example, are accepted well and truly in our community. But when I spoke with Te Tiare, they said that was until they decided to have a partner. They were accepted in terms of, you know, dressing as a woman or doing kind of what was considered female roles in society, but if they wanted to have a partner, which would be a man because they identify as a woman, that was seen as wrong. So there's, you know, there's lots of
complexities in the way the data falls out really when you start to look at it. So yeah, that was the first time we kind of knew those, because it's the first time we'd asked those questions. Kids go to their friends and their lovers first. The parents are almost the last on the list of who they would go to for information about anything to do with sexuality. And I personally feel that that's an indictment on ourselves as adults. I think that I want to be the first person that my children ask. I want to be askable. I don't want them to be too scared to ask me. The kids told me that if they ask their parents about anything to do with sex, they get away. And I think that's wrong. You want your kids to come to you if they need information, because if you don't give them that information, they will go somewhere else and it might not be good information. You want your kid to get good information. So this finding was really interesting compared to all of the other literature, because young Cook Islanders are using their sexual experiences to gain information. So that was really different. Well, when I looked at the literature, there wasn't any literature to show other where that was happening. So that's counter to what we normally see. Lots of young people participated in sexual relationships, the tap and gap. It wasn't in the realm of being in a relationship. They weren't, you know, dating each other and seeing each other for months or whatever and then entering into sex. They were having sex. It was like a screening process, I think. It was like, I have sex with you, and if this works out, you might be worth keeping on, but if it's crap, I'm sorry, you're moving on. You know, so
that kids do have access to this information, because I know that
the young people that have been through this program have said that it's really been enlightening for them, and learned lots of things that they know that will take through in the rest of their lives. So I guess my whole idea was around the tivaevae was it shaped my research, it shaped my questions, it even shaped the way, so I actually formed my chapter squares in here. So they were called, so this is like a metaphorical tivaevae that shows how sexuality is in the Cook Islands. And then I took the tivaevae research framework and I used those values in each of the lessons. And then at the end of each lesson, this is what's called a critical thinking tivaevae. This is the sheet they fill in at the end of each lesson. So all of the squares are questions from different people and then what do they think. And so by the time they finish these lessons, they have their own kind of idea about their own sexuality tivaevae. What are the values that I would want in any intimate relationships that I have? What are the skills I need to take into these things? What do I need to think to keep myself healthy, but also my partner healthy? If it's not working out, do I have the skills to leave that? Or, you know, if I'm angry, am I going to hit my partner? Or, you know, there's lots of other ways that you can hurt your partner. You know, like that young boy said, oh, I just had, you know, she hurt me, so I'm going to have sex with my best friend to hurt her back. So those are very, you know, painful experiences without having physical violence involved. Yeah. So that's kind of